Good afternoon, respected jury members, organizing committee members, and my fellow participants. The topic for my presentation is Hot Truth, Inequality and Quantity Assessment in Incinerated Truth. I'm kind to change the slide, please. Various events can lead to burned children, which may include transport accidents such as aircraft and rail accidents, suicides, and terrorist attacks. These events may display variable results on human remains. Conventional methods of identification, such as visual identification and fingerprint, have been rendered redundant in cases where the body is burned beyond recognition. Teeth and bones have a good fortune of surviving really high temperatures. Teeth are excellent sources of genomic and mitochondrial DNA because of its location and dental pulp. Here, being surrounded by hard tissues is preserved from extreme environmental conditions. Hence, the DNA, which is presently abundant in the pulp, also remains preserved. With the advent of PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction technique, even small amounts of DNA recovered from the tissues can be characterized and be used for DNA fingerprinting. This technique can be valuable in identification of victims of crime or disasters when conventional methods fail. Stable isotope analysis of the tested light luminescent teeth is only possible up to a heat exposure of 300 degrees Celsius, while the isotopic signal from strontium remains unaltered even in teeth and bones exposed to very high temperatures. DNA analysis is theoretically possible up to a heat exposure of 600 degrees Celsius, but cannot be advised in every case because of the increased risk of contamination. While the macroscopic color and UV fluorescence of cremated teeth give hints of true temperature exposure of bone's outer surface, its histological appearance can be used as a reliable indicator for the assessment of the overall degree of burning. Heat is an extremely destructive force that changes not only the architecture and morphology, but also the elemental and isotopic composition of the teeth. Recovery is possible only after stabilization of the sample. The incinerated sample is very fragile and needs the external support from acrylic or natural glue. Lab procedures begin with recording the radiographic, photographic, and scan data. Color changes range from lower to higher temperatures, we will see in the next slide, and texture changes ranging from flaky appearance to the husky appearance. Well, dehydration, decomposition, inversion, and fusion are the phases which describe the stages of heat modification process which occurs in the tissue. DNA is considered to be one of the primary identifiers by Interpol itself. Commercial cremation occurs at a temperature and duration that destroys all organic materials, including DNA, and chemical analysis is rather used to determine the elemental composition of the cremation. Coming to the colors now, we see that it is a systematic change from the lower temperature to the higher temperature, which starts in the typical light yellow of the unaltered dentine to black, to brown or olive, to gray, and lastly, it becomes completely white. The dentine exhibited the greatest amount of change, turning to a dark reddish brown color. Coming to the destructive versus the non-destructive method. Initially, we had seen already how a non-destructive method can be helpful. But here, I'll tell you, non-destructive method certainly has great advantages. But in this particular case, where the remain is incinerated, it is seen that the destructive method was more useful and gave better results as compared to the non-destructive one. The main aim of this poster was to understand the effect of heat on the quality and quantity of DNA, and if it is possible to assess the results from colorimetry. So yes, color changes due to heat are quite static and can surely help in assessing the results. The color and the mass analysis can be assessed more technically using different techniques, namely the thermogravimetric technique, which even analyzes the mass of the remains. Please change to the next slide. There are certain limitations that I came across when I was just studying the different studies published in the journal. The protection provided by the alveolar socket is nowhere replicated in the lab atmosphere. The destruction caused by heat is variable and cannot be specified always. A variety of factors influence the quality and quantity of DNA present, all of which is not reproducible in the lab setting. Within the limitations of the study, it could be concluded that in case of fire disasters where bodies get charred, by knowing the temperature and also the duration of exposure, it is possible to estimate the quantity of DNA that can be obtained from the gentle skull. This can determine whether amplification could be carried out with the amount of DNA retrieved, because insufficient DNA may provide only a partial profile or a no profile at all. Thank you so much for your patience hearing. That's all for my presentation.